Welcome everybody. Today we will dive deep into another submarine simulation. This is Cold Waters and I'll be playing with the Epic mod. The Epic mod makes this game a lot more realistic and challenging. So we'll be using that. And I will be playing a campaign from start to finish or for as long as I survive, and I will be uploading the whole campaign and episodes on YouTube. So you can look forward to much more regular uploads in the future. Now I will be playing the Soviet Union campaign 1968 in the North Atlantic. The backstory is basically it's 1968, the Soviet Union invaded Czechoslovakia to crush the reformist government there. America didn't care because they're still fighting Soviet troops in Vietnam. And so the Soviets decided, you know what, we can grab part of Europe too, and so they are going for West Germany. So our main goal in this campaign will be to disrupt the NATO's supply convoys from the US to Europe. And the main objective of NATO will be to prevent this. Now, let's start. There are a lot of submarines to choose from, ranging from ballistic submarines to attack submarines, also some submarines that are like really old, which I would not like to take. Also, there will be some, yeah, basically almost World War II technology somewhere in the selection of the submarines. I actually will not choose a submarine myself. I will let the game assign one to me, so I'll just hit random. But if I get assigned a nuclear armed submarine, so a nuclear missile armed submarine, then I will choose something else, because this game doesn't do nuclear explosions, and yeah, the purpose of the submarine is therefore kind of wasted. So let's just hit random and see what happens. Okay, Charlie 1 class K87. All right. So I've just read up on this submarine a little bit. So K87 was launched and commissioned in 1968, commissioned in December of 1968. So we are basically getting a brand new submarine. And a nice one too. The Charlie 1 is a nice submarine. It has vertical launch tubes on the bow here, 8 of them. Torpedoes up here in the front. Very nice. Also a nice selection of weapons, ranging from anti-ship missiles to torpedoes, even decoys. So that's nice. Yeah, we're going for it. It's loud though. That's its issue. It's a loud submarine. So, the Epic mod is in parts still in development. You will notice that some of these press release texts will have small translation errors in them. That's not so bad though. I will try to read them as they are intended and not as they are written. Red Oppression. Forces of the Warsaw Pact, led by the Soviet Union, invaded Czechoslovakia today with 250,000 troops supported by some 2,000 tanks, brutally suppressing the reformist movement there. The United States has stated that NATO will not intervene on behalf of the Prague Spring, effectively giving the USSR a free hand to do as it pleases. Analysts believe this attitude stems from heavy American involvement in Vietnam and President Johnson's reluctance to jeopardize the impending SALT talks. Oh, this looks bad. Rolling Thunder. Recent heavy air raids by the US in Vietnam reiterate the current administration's desire to show strong resolve in the Vietnam conflict on behalf of South Vietnam, said SecDef McNamara. Meanwhile, anti-war protests continue to grow, leading some analysts to believe the US might be seeking a way out of the conflict. SOAR talks continue. President Johnson and Premier Brezhnev met today in order to settle the new Strategic Arms Limitation Treaty, which would see many older weapons scrapped. Analysts, however, believe older weapons will be scrapped in favor of procuring newer, more effective weapons. Oh, nice rocket artillery battery. This game has some really nice artwork for the story screens here. Alright, Brezhnev strikes back. At a recent congress of the Polish United Workers' Party last week, Soviet Premier Brezhnev stated, "When forces that are hostile to socialism try to turn the development of some socialist country towards capitalism, it becomes not only a problem of the country concerned, but a common problem and a concern of all socialist countries." He then went on to throw thinly veiled accusations at West Germany for supporting reformist movements within the socialist bloc. A Pentagon spokesman revealed that NATO was aware of what amounted to a huge mobilization of Pact forces along the East German border, partaking in what appeared to be a snap exercise. Meanwhile, the US remains fully committed to the conflict in Southeast Asia. Something tells me they should be worried. Brezhnev strikes again. Crack Soviet units, supported by massive rocket barrages, smashed through the German border today in a surprise attack that appears to involve both armored units and airborne assaults behind NATO lines. Although prepared for battle, NATO has been caught off guard and is on the retreat. The White House announced that a state of war now exists between the US and the USSR and resolved to support our NATO allies, whatever the cost may be. A Pentagon spokesman said that although supply convoys would reach Europe within the week, until then NATO units will just have to hold the line. And there we go. It is the 25th of November 1968, 11 o'clock. We are docked at Murmansk, and these are our mission orders. According to satellite intelligence, a wolf pack of enemy submarines with cruise missiles on board is preparing to leave their bases in the very near future towards north. Okay, the translation errors I mentioned. This is one of them. So they are preparing to leave their base Norfolk in the very near future. According to the intelligence report, they may set a course for the Northern Barents Sea area, where they will start wreaking havoc. Our main task is to find and destroy those enemy submarines. Also, we should avoid detection by the patrol forces of the enemy. We can choose our weapons as we wish. We can maintain radio silence. My crew is still inexperienced by completing missions and sinking targets, etc. They will gain experience and some systems of the submarine will work better. Yeah, let's continue. And let's see what kind of weapons we can take with us. So, this is a very nice selection of weapons here. Let's see, the SET-65 is a torpedo with active and passive guidance. I'm not sure if it is wire guided though. I think it is. No, it isn't. No, I think it isn't. But I can fire them off and I can activate active sonar. Or I can set them up to activate their sonar system once they reach the activation point. This should improve the accuracy also against, for example, submarines. So it's good to have them. The 53-65M torpedoes. Those are surface running torpedoes that are wake homing. That means if they pass through a ship's wake, they will recognize that and then they will start to follow that wake until they reach the ship and hit it. So these are purely anti-shipping. Then we have the SAET-60M torpedoes. These are torpedoes with a passive guidance system, and as far as I know, they are meant to be fired in self-defense against enemy destroyers, for example, that are coming towards you. The SCT-40 torpedoes, those are relatively small torpedoes meant for our 400mm tubes here. There we go. And they can be used against submarines. They are primarily an anti-submarine weapon. Then we have the MG-14. This is a decoy. We have four of those, that's good. We'll have one in the tube. And then we have some SSN-7 missiles. These are, yeah, anti-shipping missiles that are stored in our vertical launch tubes. So we have 8 of those. So in total we have 18 torpedoes or decoys and 8 missiles. This is a very nice selection for the submarine. It's quite heavily armed, to be honest. Since we are expected to go against a submarine force, we should have these things. 4 of them, that's good. Some decoys, that's good. Will I need these ones? 2 should be enough. They are purely for self-defense. I might load one into a tube. The wake-homing torpedoes, I don't think we'll need them. If we do, however, we have 2 of those and we will load them into the tubes if required. So this is our loadout for now. We will leave the harbor with this loadout. So yeah, how this game works is basically when you are in port, you can modify your loadout and repair your boat. Although when you're in port, that gets done automatically. You can see that all the main systems are basically modeled in the game. And if they get damaged, you can send damage control parties, etc. So let me just check again. They are sailing from Norfolk and they are sailing towards the Northern Barents Sea. This is where we will try to find them. Let's go. So, how does this work? This part of the game is the strategic layer, the strategic map basically. On this map you can move your submarine, and this is also where the enemy will move their forces. Let's just move for a little bit so that I can show you what I mean. Okay, now you see a few icons moving around. This here is a satellite, one of ours. This is a recon plane, also one of ours. And this here that was flying up and down here, that's an enemy recon plane. You can be spotted by recon planes or by recon satellites, and then the enemy will vector hunter groups, hunter killer groups towards you, or hunter submarines, all that fun stuff. These blue lines here and as well as here, they are sonus listening stations. So it's basically hydrophone arrays on the seafloor, and they will pick me up when I pass them, and the enemy will know that I'm there. My submarine is quite noisy, so even if I go slow, there's not much chance of avoiding detection. Yeah, but right now I don't have to go through here because they will be coming to the Barents Sea from Norfolk, so from up here. It might be a while until they arrive, but I can basically stay in friendly waters until then. Let's kick this off and just slowly move around here. Now here you can see this is some enemy shipping, a supply convoy. Here, submarines arriving from Norfolk. This is some intel information. That should be our target. So now we have to wait for those and hope that one of our recon flight picks them up. Yeah, I'm pretty sure this is our target. We will wait for them in the Barents Sea, and once they arrive, we will hunt them. Yeah, there they are. Or maybe those ones? We'll just have to see. Okay. The closer they get to the Soviet Union, the bigger the chances that a recon flight will pick them up. And we can then go ahead and hunt them down. But yeah, it looks like they are coming nicely into the Barents Sea here. Oh, look, there's a whole submarine fleet moving around. Yeah, okay. Yeah, this is them. I'll just lay in wait. Where are they? Oh, god damn it. They turned. They changed course. I didn't see that one coming. Okay, let's go slowly towards them. Okay, there we have it. We have a new sonar contact, bearing 2-5, designated Sierra 1. We are at a depth of 46 meters, at a heading of 79 degrees, with a speed of 10 knots. There's a very strong surface duct and a strong thermal layer at 73 meters. I will explain what that means in a moment. Clear day, calm seas. Yeah, let's go. We are under the ice. So, how exactly does this game play? Basically, this is now the combat phase. Before I start to explain all the systems, I have to get a move on and make sure. Okay, we have a contact. Sierra 1. We can try to find out what Sierra 1 is by looking at its noise signature and comparing this to the signatures that we have in our files. And we see this might be a match. A Valiant. Okay, what kind of torpedoes does it have? Those are not very good. That's perfect. So this screen basically helps you identify your target. It gives you some information about the effectiveness of your own sensors and also the effectiveness of the enemy sensors. For example, right now I can see that if the enemy is indeed in the position that we assume it is, assume is an important word here, then they might be able to pick me up on their passive sonar, which is really not good. Let me turn towards them. Let me also see, they are above the layer. Let's get below the layer ourselves. And let's try to sneak up on them a bit while I explain what we can see here. So these numbers up here, they refer to my own submarine, my course, my speed, my depth, the rudder angle, the dive plane angle, and the ballast. Then this is for my contact, the bearing to the contact's course, if I have already determined it, the contact speed, estimated right now, because my contact solution is still not good enough, the range to the contact that I assume for now, and my contact solution. So the contact solution basically tells me Sierra 2. The solution basically tells me how sure. I've lost both of them. Okay, the solution basically tells me. Thank you, comrade. The solution basically tells me how sure my crew, my fire directors are of the enemy's position. Okay, this will be another submarine. The question is, what is it? Is it a Nautilus? Could be. Very possible. Let's keep looking if there's anything else that is matching the signature. The Nautilus is still my best bet. Yeah, I think the Nautilus might indeed be my best bet here. Let's classify this as a Nautilus. And it is deeper than I am. This is why I have picked it up on sonar again. Alright. Alright. So you can see the contact solution for the Nautilus is 32%, and you can see how the contact is jumping around on the map. That is because as my crew is computing the bearing to target, my own position, updating all that, they're doing a target motion analysis, and the longer they can keep the contact and measure the bearing to the contact, the better they can calculate its exact position, its course and its speed. So once we get to a contact solution of at least 90%, we have a really good guess where the contact is, at what depth it is, its course and its speed. Then here we have weapons data. We will see that later when I actually start to fire torpedoes. Then down here we have our speed controls. I can set speed manually, I can also just give helm orders. Right now I've ordered the submarine to run silent, so the crew is making as little noise as possible. For example, the reloading of torpedo tubes will be stopped, repairs will be stopped, and the ship's propeller is moving at very slow RPMs. Then here are the depth controls. I can set my depth, I can order periscope depth, I can order an emergency dive or an emergency blow. Then this is some sensor controls here. I can raise the periscope, the ESM mast. The ESM mast detects radar. And then I have my own radar that I can activate. And I also have active sonar. I will explain the difference between active and passive sonar a little bit later, once this whole thing starts to go critical here. And I also have 20 decoys on board that I can use to confuse torpedoes that are fired at me. So, what else? Let me just look something up. Okay, the Nautilus has Mark 37 torpedoes. Yeah, okay. The good thing about those torpedoes is they are super slow. Yeah, which is good. The Mark 16 torpedoes are no danger to me. They are surface running torpedoes, basically World War II surface running torpedoes that are used against shipping. And the Mark 37 torpedoes I can pretty much outrun. Oh, I should be able to. What is the speed of my Charlie submarine? Ah, well, submerged speed of 25 knots, so yeah, they are 1 knot faster than me. Still, I should be able to outrun them, to basically keep ahead of them for so long that they run out of steam and self-detonate. Yeah. Yeah, we are under the ice of the Barents Sea. So this is really a place for submarines to hunt each other. Now, on the right side here, to continue the explanation of the systems here, I have a few tabs that I can select. The conditions tab tells me the ambient noise in the water. 75 decibels is very quiet, actually. especially since we're under the ice. That's unusually quiet. There is a very strong duct and a strong layer. So the thermal layer. The thermal layer is something that happens once you have a rapid change in temperature as the depth increases. And what that does is basically it creates a barrier that sound has difficulties to pass through. So if there's a ship on the surface above the layer and I'm below the layer, then the sound that the ship makes might be trapped beneath between the layer and the surface and just bounce between those two things but not penetrate below the layer. So I might be deaf to the ship and the ship might be completely deaf to me. Since the Nautilus is going above the layer, or at least this is what my crew estimates, I fully expect to lose the contact. But we'll see about that. So the seafloor is at 291 meters right here. We can just barely see it down there. Then the signature tab, I already explained a little bit. So everything, every contact has a noise signature, and this is the signatures that I have on file up here, and this is what my submarine's hydrophones actually pick up right now. So this is a waterfall display, and this is what we can hear basically at this moment while focusing on this contact. We also have our active sonar. So the passive sonar is basically just the hydrophones of the submarine. My sonar crew is just listening to the noises in the water. The active sonar sends out a ping from my submarine, and then my crew is listening for the returning echoes of that ping. And if that ping is sent out and it travels through the water and it hits an enemy submarine, it gets reflected back towards me and my crew can pick that up. And depending on how the return sound sounds and how long it took for the sound to come back to me, they can pretty much say what we are up against and where it is and where it's moving. So active sonar is very powerful in making sure that you know the exact position of your adversaries here in the water. But it also gives away your own position because you are emitting active sound waves. Then we have our weapons tab. Here we can have a look at what we have in our submarine loaded. We have some weapon guidance controls here. I don't think that the Charlie 1 has any wire capabilities, so I don't think I can fire wire-guided torpedoes. Which is a shame, because wire-guided torpedoes are awesome. So these, yeah, it says down here, wires 0. I don't have any wires. So I cannot use these controls here. I can just fire off a torpedo, tell it where it has to go, and I can program some specific things, like for example with the Z-65 torpedoes, I can tell the torpedo to go to activate its own active sonar system once it reaches the activation point, and then I can tell the torpedo to either proceed straight forward, to go in a zigzag pattern, or to circle in a specific direction. I can also tell the torpedo to stay at depth, to go up to the surface, or to go deeper once it activates. I will set up the torpedoes to be active homing with a zigzag pattern to them and to stay at depth for now. This one, the SAET-60M, I can, yeah, you see it does not have any active guidance, it has just its own passive guidance, but that's fine. This torpedo, as we said anyway, is just there for for basically self-defense. And then there's this. This is also an anti-submarine torpedo. Yeah, I will also set this up to have a zigzag pattern with active homing enabled. The decoy, it can stay as is. I will just tell it to maybe go up to the surface or to stay at depth. Good question. For now, I leave it like this. Our solution for the Nautilus is still pretty bad, but we are slowly getting closer and our solution will improve over time. In fact, let's change course a little bit and go more to Then here we have our damage control. If some part of the submarine gets damaged, then I can send... Yeah, then I can send damage control parties to that part of the submarine. But for now... We will stay at silent running. So yeah, that were the torpedo systems, the submarine systems. So now you know everything about what you see on the screen. Now we will proceed to hunt this Nautilus and this Valiant. I can also use time compression to speed up the process.
Товарищ командир, потерян контакт. Последний белем 3-5-4. Сигнал затухает.
We lost the contact, but that's fine. I expect it to be above the layer, so we will use this opportunity to get closer to them. I would really love to increase my own speed, but...
Возобновлен контакт, белем 3-5-3.
Yeah, we're getting a good solution on the Valiant. Ah, well, we aren't. Solution is still not good. Not good enough, at least. The Valiant. Let's have a look at that contact. Did I select it? Yeah, I did. Why is it not showing me the Valiant up here? Permit, skip check, sturgeon... Valiant, there it is. What kind of torpedoes does it have? Mark 20S. These are slow. This is good. Passive acoustic homing. Okay. And Mark 8 torpedoes. Ah, that's also basically a World War II torpedo. Just straight running on the surface. So both submarines cannot endanger me in a significant way. That's good to know. Unfortunately, this one even has a towed sonar, something that I don't have. So its chances of picking me up are not bad if it deploys that towed sonar. Apparently it's also above the layer. So I'll just use time compression again to get closer to them. And just go there slightly. Oh no. We have more contacts. Again, looking at the noise signature and trying to match it to something that we know about. Goopy? Possible? Resolution. Nah, it's not this one. Ah, damn it. So this is getting more complicated by the minute. Okay, we are already past all the submarine contacts. This could also be something like a trawler, maybe, although with the eyes above, that is a little bit unlikely. Oh boy. Let's classify this as a goopy phone.
Товарищ командир, докладываю гидроакустик. Sierra 3, опознан как подводная лодка.
Contact Sierra 4. Very weak readings on that one. That could be anything. But here, it looks to me like there's a line here. Could just be my imagination though. I'll observe. I'll keep closing in and observing the contacts. I have good contact on the Guppy. And on the Valiant even.
Товарищ командир, потерян контакт. Последний пилим. 3, 5, 2.
And I lost them. I lost them all.
Возобновлен контакт, пилим. 3, 5, 2.
Still though, we definitely have a submarine battle on our hands here. Try to close in. Okay, we have good contact on the Guppy. Now we can also see it. The Guppy 2, it's basically an upgraded World War II submarine. So I'm not very afraid of this one. It's diesel electric, so it's quiet, but this one is running at a speed of 8 knots, which is already pretty fast for this thing. It only has a speed of 17.5 knots that it can achieve underwater. I'll keep closing in. Range to target. Yeah, 2.7 kilometers. That's not a lot. The question is, where's everything else?
Yeah,
I got new contact on Sierra 4, and this time I have a good reading. It might be the Tang. My oh my, my first mission, and I'm going up against 4 submarines at once. Yeah, it's a Tang. It's definitely a Tang. Oh, and this was active sonar. Something is pinging. And if they're pinging, they know I'm here. I believe it's the Tang that's pinging. Yeah, it has me definitely on active sonar. Okay, prepare to fire. Yeah, torpedoes in the water. Torpedoes are in the water. You can see it here. Okay, we fired off a bunch of torpedoes. Flank speed, change our course. We are cavitating, going deep. They have wire-guided torpedoes. You can see this. Their torpedoes are going... They adjusted the path of their torpedoes to account for my course change. We are no longer cavitating. So cavitation is something that happens when your screw is moving way too fast in the water. And cavitation is producing a lot of noise. A lot of that. Okay, for now I fired the spread of torpedoes at them. The torpedoes will soon reach the activation point. And then the fight is on. I hope that my torpedoes will have the effect that it's breaking their target locks. Their wires especially, so that they cannot send their torpedoes after me anymore. Because if the submarine starts to maneuver violently, then the wire can actually break. Oh, you made an oopsie. You made a mistake. Oh, yeah. That's bad for you. The Goopy is going down. This one has also been hit. Very good. Good results so far. But we have a bunch of torpedoes going after me. Let's try to get out of the way. The Nautilus? This is not the Nautilus. Or is it? Yeah, this is the Nautilus. It had also been hit. Very good. And the Dreadnought, which has also already been hit once, is about to be hit again. Yeah, it's trying to confuse the torpedo with a noisemaker. However, this is not working. It's blowing the ballast to get to the surface. But up there is only ice. Yeah, you're toast. So the Dreadnought is also sinking. So right now, what is left? The Nautilus is left somewhere, and the Tang is left. We have good contact on the Nautilus. Let's have a look. It has, yeah, the Nautilus has been hit already once. So it might be flooding. We lost contact to the Tan. The Nautilus might be flooding. If it's flooding and it's going down to 291 meters, it's going to crush. With that damage already sustained, it's not surviving that. So, a few enemy torpedoes have already activated, but since they lost their wires, they were not able to guide them towards me. There's still one torpedo that is being guided towards me. It might be guided by the Nautilus. I will, for the moment, just run away. That got pretty loud, didn't it? Jesus. But alright, we made it so far, that's good. And since we are running... why didn't I do this earlier? Let's reload our tubes. While we are running away, let's talk a little bit about Silent Hunter 5 and what's going on with that game. I guess some of you are anxious to know when more episodes or more tutorials will be coming. Well, I'm sad to say that it won't be for some time. I have managed to lose all my save games for Silent Hunter 5, which was an incredibly frustrating experience, I can tell you. And right now, I do not know when I will continue with that game or when I'll do something similar, because after playing Silent Hunter 5 and surviving until mid-1942, basically until the end of Operation Drumbeat, and then losing the save games... Yeah, thank you very much, comrade. Losing the save games after putting up with Silent Hunter 5's issues for a very long time. Bravo, I have...
Yeah,
thank you. I have to be honest and say that I'm really kind of lacking the motivation to start a new campaign. Silent Hunter 5 just has too many issues. And... yeah, it's painful. I would have loved to finish the war from start to finish,
but...
I really don't feel like I'm starting anew from the beginning. What I could do is to start, basically use the Silent Auto cheat code and go right into the next campaign chapter. But that's just not the same thing. If you understand what I mean. It's just not the same as playing the whole thing from start to finish. The continuity is missing. And so, for the moment, I'm really not sure what I will do. Maybe I'll do some more Silent Hunter 5, or maybe I'll do Silent Hunter 3, actually. Because a fully modded Silent Hunter 3 has more gameplay options, more possibilities, more features, and also, I think, better AI than a fully modded Silent Hunter 5 has. So I might actually go and do a campaign in that game. But I'm, at the moment, just not sure about that. I might... what I will definitely do for the next time is to play this Cold Waters campaign here. And maybe something completely unrelated from time to time. This torpedo is sticking to me. And... I think the only way to get rid of the torpedo is to make sure that whatever fired it is losing its wires. So yeah, that is the situation with Silent Hunter 5 that I'm in right now. It's really sad and it is really incredibly frustrating to me, because I got so far and I survived up until that point too. Actually, my captain was, if you look at the KSD commander statistics, I think I was like, I don't know, among the top 30 or something like that. Excluding all the people who obviously cheated with their tonnage scores. It's really sad. But yeah, Cold Waters is also a very nice game, which is, especially together with the epic mod, very realistic and very immersive also. And I will be playing this campaign and I'll just see how it goes. And I'll try to explain what I do, what is happening. It's a little bit hard when you are facing such a submarine fleet as this one. I really hope this was my mission target and not just some patrol that was sent out here, but yeah. We'll see about that. So for now, how can I get rid of this torpedo? Let's switch on our active sonar and get a fix on our remaining enemies. The Nautilus is still alive, although still in a precarious position because of the flooding. The Tang is still alive. Now, what kind of torpedo do I have on me? A Mark 37, by the looks of it. So that means this thing was fired by the Tang. Let me reward the Tang by making sure... I will fire a torpedo at the Tang just to make sure that it has to maneuver and hopefully lose its wire, which will then render this torpedo completely ineffective. Also, I need to do something before they reload their tubes and fire another salvo at me. Eyes ahead. Yeah, I know. We're cavitating, that's fine. So, we cannot fire a torpedo at this speed. That would be... it wouldn't manage to get out of the tube, it would get jammed in the tube. And then the tube would be... well, broken, until we get back to port. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to order back emergency. And we will slow down the boat. And then we will go and... we will fire our torpedo in the direction of the tank. Then we will go back to flank speed. So now the tank will have something to think about. While we go back down. We just have to make sure that the tank is losing the wires. If that happens, then we can simply get out of the way of this torpedo and finish off the Nautilus. Let's set up our other torpedoes as well while we are at it. Something is launching noisemakers. That's alright, my torpedo will find you anyway. It's going directly towards the tank. If the tank doesn't change course soon, then it's pretty much good. But I suspect the tank is trying to keep its wires intact. Yeah, you can see this is my submarine in the background there. And I think my torpedo has acquired. Or it should at any moment activate. It's hard to say. Did it activate already? Yeah, there we go. Now it's active. Oh no, it's going for the noisemaker behind the tank. Yeah, this is my torpedo. The noisemaker has just disappeared. But there's another noisemaker further down the line, so... we were not successful. The tank hasn't evaded me because of the noisemakers dropped by the Nautilus. It's alright though, we'll just fire another one. Back emergency. Change course. Sharp turn. Set up the torpedo. That's fine. Go forward again. Fire the torpedo like this. The tank will not evade this one. There it is. This torpedo will activate in a few moments. And I will plot my course to go like this. Yeah. My torpedo is going directly for the tank. This is the enemy's torpedo down here. My submarine is just so much faster than theirs, so I can run circles around them. For 1968, so the Soviets they had very capable submarines, and they really did have the better torpedoes. The NATO torpedoes were quite bad compared to what the Soviets had. There goes the tank. So that should be it for the torpedo here. What about the Nautilus? What about my other torpedo? What happened to that one? I don't know, but let's slow down. Back emergency. Okay, forward again. Fire off the torpedo like this. So this was our last SCT-40 torpedo. And we have a lock on the Nautilus. Torpedo is going directly forward. We turn off our active sonar now. Goodbye. That should be a hit. Ah, it's dropping countermeasures. So what the countermeasures do is basically they produce a lot of noise, so torpedoes get attracted to them. But once the torpedo is past the countermeasure, it will pick up the submarine again if it didn't get out of the way fast enough. And since this Nautilus sustained damage, it's not fast enough anymore. So this is going to be a hit. There's another countermeasure. But again, once the torpedo is through that, it's going straight back after the Nautilus. So, this is a nice collection of shipwrecks down here. Guppy, Nautilus, and what was the other one? Dreadnought. Guppy, Nautilus, Dreadnought, Tang. Nice. There we go. Now, once this torpedo, this enemy torpedo that is searching for us, is far enough away, we can leave the combat. I'll actually use time compression. After all that just went down here, I don't think there's anything else in the area. Otherwise it would have already fired at us. So all is fine. There goes the torpedo. Ah, well, that was fun. And it self-detonated. Now that we have no contact anymore, we can leave the area. And so let's do that, leave combat. And this is our after-action report. We sunk a Dreadnought, a Nautilus, a Guppy, and a Tang. This is the weapons that we still have remaining. We expended a lot of torpedoes on those targets. We gained some experience for our crew, so that's nice. And yes, this was our target. Great job, you were able to ensure the safe movement of our ships in this area. Await additional orders on this downlink. Awesome. And the campaign is progressing. From the Presidium of the Supreme Soviet of the USSR in Moscow. The Presidium of the Supreme Soviet of the USSR expresses its heartfelt congratulations and awards with great pleasure for distinction in military service of the second degree to Commander Tonchi, me, commanding officer of K-87. this medal. Nice. For distinction in military service, second degree. Yeah, okay. Commander Tonchi is awarded for extraordinary heroism in action against the enemies of the Soviet Union, 29th of November 1968. His unwavering determination and selfless dedication in the face of death are worthy of the highest emulation. Yes, I agree. I'm awesome. And this is how the campaign's story is progressing. So, from time to time, and after each mission, you will receive a new press release. NATO submarines are scared. Incidents involving attacks on transatlantic convoys by hostile submarines in and around Northern Barents Sea have rapidly decreased. An anonymous representative offered to increase the volume of Soviet submarines operations in the area, but at the same time, Moscow refused such demands. Offered to increase the volume. Yeah, translation errors. Without the threat of attack from submarines, transatlantic crossings become more efficient and suffer fewer losses. If this improved flow of supplies and military supplies is sustained, the Soviet forces will be able to engage up to the Iron Curtain. Nice. And we have our new orders. A deserter who left the Arctic Circle and contacts with NATO forces pose a threat to our fatherland. Okay, so basically a deserter who left the Arctic Circle and contacted NATO forces poses a threat to our fatherland. Recent intelligence reports indicate that the deserter is planning to head to Newport. Your orders are to intercept and destroy the traitor. Okay. Find additional tasks, find and sync NATO contact points if possible. That's a nice mission, so we are basically playing Hunt for Red October now. Awesome movie, by the way, and also awesome book. Yeah, my crew proficiency level is now trained crew, we have gained some experience. And this means that our tube reload is 2 seconds faster. Noisemaker reload 2 seconds faster. Nice. Radar range increased by 1 kilometer. Signal noise from speed reduced by 2%. That's nice. Let's continue. Just again. So he's sailing from the Arctic Circle towards Newport. Okay. I don't know if it's a surface contact or a submarine, but I assume it's a submarine. We have 3 torpedoes remaining that can sink a submarine. Alright. Awesome. Oh boy. Okay, let me pause here. Arctic Circle. And he's going towards Newport. I will have to haul ass to get there. And since this area up here is full of enemy submarines, I will have to go through the Sonus barrier here. And then straight towards the Danish Strait. But this will be all for this episode right now. I think it has been long enough already. And I will be continuing this campaign and uploading a new episode regularly, so you won't have to wait weeks or months for new episodes. Ain't that nice? Thank you very much for watching, and I hope the Silent Hunter 5 news has not shocked you too much, and I hope that you are enjoying this campaign in cold waters. I sincerely hope you do. If you have any comments about this, any advice or any questions, feel free to ask in the comments. Those that are here for some time know that I answer questions in the comments pretty fast. Again, thank you for your time, and until the next episode, goodbye.